Welcome to CryoHist. We will see CryoHist technology in action as we resect skin cancers and obtain histologic margins, getting the surface cut by the surgeon's knife onto glass slides. A brief introduction regarding Frederick Mohs, who pioneered the technique some 50 years ago, followed by cases, followed by a comparison of frozen sections and permanent sections, followed by tissue-orienting film with an inherent specimen numbering system and the use of a new fiber-reinforced embedding medium, the rapid processing of 9 specimens. We will also go into how we cut large frozen sections. We will also have a brief overview of methodology illustrations of current techniques and those which may be applied in the future for malignancies other than skin cancer. Dr. Frederick Mohs used a zinc chloride chemical fixation technique some 50 years ago for detection of tumor roots. Drawbacks were that the tissue had to be cut in a beveled fashion, and it was painful and time-consuming and laborious for the patient and physician alike. Dr. Ted Tromovich modified the method using frozen sections. This greatly sped up the process, and once clear margins were attained, defects were immediately reconstructed. Histologic margins are important in that they represent the interface between the patient and the cancer. Slide quality is essential for precise interpretation. It is extremely important in patient care. The standard ink margins used today determine the distance between the edge of the tumor and the surgical surface. Bear in mind that the location of the microscopic tumor extensions are not predictable. End face margins are ideal. They examine the surgical surface cut by the surgeon's knife for tumor extensions, and if tumor is seen on the slide, the surgeon has cut through a root and a further resection is warranted. End face margins are not routinely done in hospitals because of the technical difficulties in handling the tissue and cutting the large frozen sections and examining them microscopically. Histologic margins are critical to guide the surgeon's hands, since he or she cannot see the microscopic cancerous extensions and must preserve vital structures. The pathologist is limited in that he cannot direct the surgeon's hands unless he sees where the tumor extensions are on the microscope slide. As mentioned, problems using frozen sections for surgical surface margins are that it is time-consuming and it is technically difficult to manipulate the tissue for proper orientation prior to freezing. As every histotech knows, it is difficult to cut beautiful frozen sections every time. It is imperative that section artifacts be minimized so interpretation can be accurate. Cutting fat is a particular problem. CryoHist gets the surface cut by the surgeon's knife onto glass slides for histologic margins. CryoHist technology improves quality. Cutting with a non-disposable knife can mean that the tissue can be cut at colder temperatures. Whole specimens can be routinely cut with relaxing incisions and inking for orientation. It is important to relax the tissue completely, since the dermal protein will contract and pull the epidermal edge out of the cutting plane. In order to consistently get the tissue that you are interested in on the glass slide, we have created the tissue-oriented film. The film has several features. It secures the tissue in a gross orientation by simple contact adherence. It is designed so that in the vacuum system, the tissue will be pulled and maintained in proper orientation against the film. It also has transferable numbers, which will keep all of your specimens in numerical order before you cut your frozen sections. The high-quality frozen sections will be produced much faster and be more precisely interpretable. CryoHist technology saves time. The benchtop unit freezes 9 specimens per cycle. The freestanding unit will freeze 18 specimens per double cycle. The tissue is always planar oriented. Fatty tissues can be taken down to minus 45 to minus 50 degrees centigrade for cutting. Freeze artifacts are minimized. As mentioned, Cutting frozen sections is much easier since the tissue is always parallel to the knife edge, and fatty tissue can be cut easily if at proper temperature. We will now be looking at actual cases of a variety of cancers. The types of cancer will include mucinous carcinoma, ecrine carcinoma, microcystic adnexal carcinoma, extramammary Paget's disease, lentigo maligna, and melanoma. These cases were chosen because they represent some of the most difficult tumors to track using frozen sections. Mucinous carcinoma represents a rare carcinoma typically affecting the head and neck with a propensity for the eyelids. It has histologic features similar to certain breast cancers. Here is the tumor evident on the left lower lid. This represents the final defect after two stages Mohs surgery. We place eyelid tissue on wooden tongue blades to stabilize the specimen when relaxing the tissue so we can get the surgical surface onto the glass slide. What we have done in this case is made two vertical incisions through the tarsus down to the junction of the lateral and deep margins. This allows both lateral margins and deep margin to be in one plane. The medial and lateral margins are color-coded with a corresponding map. A close-up of the tissue prior to it being placed in the CryoHist. It has been incisionally relaxed and color-coded. The tumor has been grossly debulked. The tissue for margins and a cross-section of tumor are placed on the cryo discs. A plastic film is placed over the tissue specimens and the vacuum conditions are initiated. This is the appearance of the tissue just prior to being frozen. Here we have the tissue frozen on an object holder in the cryostat ready to cut frozen sections. Here we have a complete margin including both lateral components. The stratified epithelium is intact, as is the conjunctiva. The deep margin is in the same plane as the lateral margins. The insets represent areas of tumor residua. The lower right-hand corner inset indicates that this is stage 1 frozen section. This represents a photomicrograph of the tumor cells. At higher magnification, some of the cells are surrounded by mucinous material, which is further illustrated on this slide. This represents the second stage. Using the map drawn for the first stage, tissue from the areas of residual tumor involvement are taken. These specimens are inked and their orientation is corresponding to the color-coded map. These represent the histologic samples of the second stage with no evidence of residual mucinous carcinoma. The patient was then referred on for oculoplastic reconstruction. The next case represents ecrine carcinoma. This is an elderly lady who had a tumor on the right ala, rapidly growing. This represents the final defect following Mohs surgery. This histologic slide shows areas of residual ecrine carcinoma in the fourth stage. Histologic appearance of the tumor cells. Ecrine carcinoma at higher magnification. Repair of the defect using a forehead transposition flap. The healed repair shows good functional and cosmetic result. Another case of ecrine carcinoma. This gentleman had a deeply infiltrating tumor involving the right mid cheek. After two aggressive stages of Mohs surgery, the tumor extended down to the parotid duct and buccal fat pad. This represents the bisected tissue sample of the first stage. The second stage with the inset showing residual ecrine carcinoma. infiltrating ecrine carcinoma. Perineural tumor involvement of the carcinoma. Higher magnification of tumor cells. The patient went on to have a parotidectomy. He also underwent radiation therapy. The next case is microcystic adnexal carcinoma. The tumor has infiltrated the dorsum of the nose. Stage 1 is inked with gentian violet. Stage 1 showing a bisected specimen, incisionally relaxed with the tumor debulked during the relaxation process and color-coded for anatomic orientation with the corresponding map. The tissue placed on the CryoHist with plastic film in place and under vacuum conditions. Embedding medium being placed around the frozen tissue. The histologic specimens from stage 1. This represents the two specimens. Of note is the nasal cartilage showing tumor involvement. Higher magnification of the cartilage and tumor cells. Tumor cells at higher magnification. Cords of infiltrating tumor cells. Palisading of tumor cells between muscle fibers. A second stage was taken, which essentially represented a partial rhinectomy. Here is the patient reconstructed with a forehead flap. She has an acceptable cosmetic and functional reconstruction. The next slide is extramammary Paget's disease. This tumor involved the right axilla of an elderly male patient. A wide resection was carried out. The frozen section represents half of the resection specimen. Photomicrograph of pagetoid cells in the epidermis. Pagetoid cells at higher magnification. The next case represents lentigo maligna. A frozen section of the cross-section of the lentigo maligna. Lentigo maligna on cross-section, frozen section at higher magnification. Lentigo maligna on frozen section. The next case is an elderly lady who has melanoma in situ with an invasive component involving the right cheek. This represents the defect following Mohs surgery. A representative slide of stage 1 showing focal areas of melanoma in situ and invasive melanoma. Frozen section stage 1 showing melanoma in situ. Melanoma cells in the granular layer. A second stage was taken, and the histology shows areas of persistent tumor involvement. The slide shows an invasive component of the melanoma. Melanoma tumor cells invading between muscle fibers. The patient had a further resection with a rotational flap reconstruction. Immediately post-reconstruction, an acceptable cosmetic and functional repair. The next case represents melanoma. This is an elderly male with a pigmented lesion on the right forehead. We were able to remove the melanoma in one-stage Mohs surgery. Cross-section of the melanoma shows melanoma cells in the basal layer. Higher magnification of the cells in the basal layer of the epidermis. Reconstruction using a full-thickness skin graft. High-quality frozen sections compare favorably with permanent sections, In the following section, we will compare frozen and permanent sections of opposing tissue sections from cross-sections of two melanoma patients. The first comparison represents melanoma in situ. We go from lower magnification on the left to higher magnification on the right. Melanoma in situ frozen section at scanning magnification. Opposing section processed for permanent sections, melanoma in situ at scanning magnification. Melanoma in situ higher magnification frozen section. Melanoma in situ opposing sections processed for permanent sections, higher magnification. Melanoma in situ frozen section, high magnification. Melanoma in situ opposing section processed for permanent section, higher magnification. Comparison of frozen sections and permanent sections, melanoma. Melanoma on frozen section. Melanoma opposing section for permanent section. Melanoma frozen section, higher magnification. Melanoma opposing section, permanent section, higher magnification. The next section will deal with tissue orienting film. This represents an illustration of how under vacuum conditions, the tissue orienting film adheres the tissue against the film by removal of the surrounding air, pulling the specimen against the TOF and the cryo disc. Specimen numbering system. When processing a number of specimens, it is imperative that the specimens be numerically labeled to keep their site-specific tabulation correct. Pictured are specimens in place on the TOF for positions 7, 8, and 9. Freeze solution is applied to the cryo disc before the specimen-loaded TOF is placed. The specimens, which have been incisionally relaxed and color-coded, placed on the numerically designated sites on the tissue-oriented film. These are then placed onto the cryo discs, which have the freeze solution in place. Once the specimens and the TOF are aligned with the numbered designated areas on the cryo disc, a plastic film is placed over the tissue on the TOF. Air pockets are removed along with individual specimen adjustments. Specimens observed under vacuum conditions on the TOF. Specimens freezing under vacuum conditions on the TOF. After the specimens are partially frozen, the plastic film is peeled back in preparation for the embedding medium placement and flipping onto the object holders. Fiber-reinforced embedding medium is placed around the specimen and acts as a picture frame to minimize distortion of the specimen during cutting. Once the tissue has been frozen onto object holders, the TOF is peeled from the specimens and the numerical labels are left on each individual specimen. This shows specimens 1, 2, and 3 with corresponding numeric labels. 9 numerically labeled specimens ready to cut frozen sections. Fiber-reinforced embedding medium. This patient has a squamous cell carcinoma in the right retroauricular region. This was excised down to mastoid and tail of the parotid. The specimen has been incisionally relaxed, tumor debulked, and color-coded with blue, red, green, orange ink. It has been placed on the TOF. Specimen frozen with plastic film being removed. Fiber-reinforced embedding media is in the warmer at approximately 110 degrees Fahrenheit. Fiber-reinforced embedding media is applied around the circumference of the tissue specimen. Plain embedding medium is placed in the central aspect of the specimen. Frozen specimen with a frame of reinforced embedding medium around the specimen ready for cutting sections. Complete histologic margins with single specimen showing some auricular cartilage at the 1 o'clock position and deep margin of parotid tissue with areas of tumor involvement. Second stage taken showing the map and the resection specimen. The next case is a squamous cell carcinoma involving the crown of the scalp. The tissue is incisionally relaxed and the tumor debulked, color-coded with red, blue, green, orange ink. It is placed on TOF. Specimen has been frozen under vacuum conditions with plastic film being peeled off. Fiber-reinforced embedding medium in the warmer at approximately 110 degrees Fahrenheit. Fiber-reinforced embedding medium being placed around the tissue specimen as a tissue-supporting frame. Fiber-reinforced embedding medium around the frozen tissue specimen. Frozen specimen in the cryostat, ready for cutting sections. Complete margin, single specimen, showing tumor root at 7 o'clock position. Marking of the patient using the map showing where the residual carcinoma is located. Reconstruction of the defect using a full thickness skin graft. Processing 9 specimens in just over 2 minutes requires that the operator be focused and attentive to detail to avoid malfrozen specimens. We will be viewing a movie of how we process 9 specimens when the need arises. The specimens, which have been incisionally relaxed and color-coded, are placed on the appropriately numerically labeled sites on the TOF. Freeze solution is applied to the cryo discs. The specimen-laden TOF is then placed onto the cryo disc such that the numbers on the TOF correspond with the numbers on the respective cryo discs. Once the specimens are in place, the plastic film is placed over the specimen and the vacuum is activated by switch. As the vacuum conditions are occurring, the object holders are taken from the moistening tray and placed into the receiving holes of the cryo discs. If necessary, embedding medium can be placed on the warm object holders after placement to ensure complete adherence of the tissue specimen to the object holder. Now the freeze cycle is activated. Once the tissue has been observed to be freezing, the plastic film is pulled off parallel to the surface to avoid displacing either the specimen or the TOF. Once the film is removed, the heated fiber-reinforced embedding medium is briskly placed around each individual specimen. Plain embedding medium can be placed on the center of each specimen. Once the smallest specimen is about 30% frozen, the specimens are flipped onto the object holders and taken to the appropriate temperature. The CryoHist is flipped open and the frozen specimens are removed from the TOF. They are placed in the cryostat for cutting. Nine specimen processing movie initiated. Freeze solution is applied to each cryo disc and allowed to puddle on the cryo disc with a diameter of 2 to 3 centimeters. Next, the tissue, which has been incisionally relaxed and color-coded, is placed on the TOF and placed onto the cryo discs. Care is taken that the numbers are aligned with the reference marks so that the specimen will be frozen to the center of the object holder. The plastic film is placed over the specimens. The vacuum phase is initiated. Object holders with their undersurface moistened with isopropyl alcohol are taken from the moisturizing tray and placed into their respective holes in the cryo discs. Final inspection of the tissue under vacuum conditions is done. If all is set to go, the freeze cycle is initiated. Once the specimens begin to freeze, the plastic film is rolled back parallel to the surface to avoid displacing either the tissue or the TOF. With the film removed, heated fiber embedding medium is placed around each individual specimen. Plain embedding medium may be placed on the center of each specimen. Once the smallest specimen is 30% frozen, the tissue is flipped onto its respective object holders and the tissue is taken to the appropriate temperature. Once the temperature is reached, the CryoHist is opened and the TOF is peeled away from each of the frozen specimens. They are now numerically labeled and ready for cutting. Cutting frozen sections still remains an art. The CryoHist systems are designed to make cutting beautiful frozen sections easier. In the Cutting Frozen Sections movie, we will show how we actually cut the tissue specimens, how fat is further chilled with liquid nitrogen spray, how the blade and anti-roll plate are also chilled with liquid nitrogen spray, and how large specimens are transferred to large glass slides using a metal spatula which is kept in the cryostat. All frozen sections were cut with a Leica 1900 cryostat using a non-disposable steel knife. Thank you. Conventional methodology. If you envisioned a tumor in the center of a sphere with a tumor root extending out to the periphery, it becomes intuitive that thousands of radially sampled tissue samples would be required to be certain the tumor root is detected. With the previous illustration in mind, it becomes apparent that end face margins are superior to thousands of radial samples of tissue for margins. Radially sampled tissue represents approximately 1/1000th of the actual surface area. This is borne out by calculating the surface area of a 4 cm diameter sphere, which turns out to have 50 square centimeters of surface area. If the amount of surface area examined using radially sampled tissue is 1/1000th of a square centimeter, it would take 50,000 slides to examine all of the surface area. This represents a small lumpectomy specimen with the surgical surface inked and the specimen bread loafed to determine the distance of the tumor from the inked surgical margins. A shift of 90 degrees changes radial samples of tissue to end face sampling of tissue, which will greatly enhance tumor root detection. Comparing this illustration to that of the conventional radially tissue sampled methodology, one can see that getting more of the surgical surface onto the glass slide will be less likely to miss tumor roots. This illustrates another method of evaluating the margins of a lumpectomy specimen with tissues sampled end face. This is another representation of obtaining the surface for margins with sections cut parallel to the inked surface. Tracking tumor extension through ductal networks poses significant challenges.